So this is a course given by Philippe Castillon, but Philippe cannot make it today, so he will come tomorrow, and he asked me to back him up and give this first lecture. He wrote a synopsis for me, and I tried to work this out, and we will see. So I don't know if you have realized that during these 2 weeks, we will talk about three different ways of talking about synthetic version of the curvature. So two which are concerned with upper curvature bound. So this morning with that hypervelocity, and today with cat condition. And one which is concerned by a lower Ricci curvature in a weak sense. And the course will be given next week, start next week by Andrea Mondino from Oxford. That might be a problem because people from Oxford were not able to connect this morning. So we'll see next week what will happen. All right, so here today I will start from the very beginning. And first of all, here are the references that you might want to look at. So certainly for me, the one that I'm using a lot is Wrightson and Fliger, which is a huge book that with plenty of things. This one. And it's called metric spaces and non-positive curvature, so it's upper bound of the curvature. And well, there is this course by Dmitry Burago, Yuri Burago, and Sergei Ivanov, which is older and which we have been using a lot in the past. It's a very good book too. And you might not know this one, and you don't know because it's not published. But there are notes on you can download on archive or on the webpage of Stephanie Alexander. So it's Stephanie Alexander, Vitaly Karpovich, and Anton Petronin. And at some point, they had notes where they would compare lower curvature bound and upper curvature bound. And that was, I used them to give a course several years ago. And that was really interesting to have these two aspects of the curvature, weak version of the curvature. Worked out in parallel. So this is something which I like very much at the moment, but for today, we'll stick to what Philip told me. He told me to do that, and I will do that. So we start like the same start than Gilles' lecture. We'll be talking about metric spaces. So metric space is a space with a metric. And so D is a distance function, which I will call a metric during this lecture. It could be a bit misleading because in Riemannian geometry, what we call a metric is not this. It's a scalar product on each tangent space, which gives rise to a distance, but it's not exactly this. So, well, we are grown up, so we can deal with that. So D is a distance. So I start very slowly. Right? From, non-negative number. And I will not insult you, I will not write the three properties of a distance, but the most important one, well, in fact, there are two which are very important. Symmetry is, okay, everybody knows that. So the two which are important is triangle inequality, which is sometimes difficult to prove. And the second one for a distance is that the distance is zero if and only if the two points coincide. If not, it's called a pseudo distance and we'll be looking at some pseudo distance during this lecture. So this makes sense to think really to lots of variation. So this morning, Gilles explained how to compute the length of a curve. So let me recall this. It was done very clearly, but still, I mean, I decided to start like this. I don't want to change my plan anyway. So a curve is just a continuous map. So let's say from a closed interval, it's not necessarily closed, but into X. And of course, we want to define the length of the curve. So the definition is the one given by Gilles this morning. Length of C is the supremum of this quantity. So equal to zero to N minus one. C T I plus one. So where T zero up to T, so that one is T n, is a partition, an increasing partition at the interval AB. And we take supremum on all possible partitions. So it's a kind of definition that you like to define something. You take the infimum or supremum and everything, right? And so it's not necessarily finite. And as Gilles said this morning, if length of C, which sometimes I will call A of C for sake of simplicity, is finite, then C is said to be rectifiable. So a rectifiable curve is a curve whose length is finite. And with the help of, so you start with a distance. With the distance, you can define a length. And with the help of the length, you can define another distance. So we call it the length metric. So the length metric is the following object, which I call D bar, defined for 2 points in X. Let me call them X and Y, which is that the infimum of the length of curves, which starts from X and I call it A, and ends at Y. So we look at all curves going from X to Y. I should have said continuous, of course, curves are always continuous. Sorry. Right, we look at all curves going from X to Y, and we compute the length and take the infimum, right? All C. And this gives a number. And it's not difficult to see that this, so first of all, so what should I say? It's not difficult to see that, so easy proposition. D bar is a metric, meaning it's a distance function in the sense that we have not written on the board. And it's always greater or equal, so it's really straightforward, stupid. For any 2 point x, y, D bar is greater or equal to D. Well, it's obvious. Right? And so this D bar has a name, which is called the length metric. And the space X D is called a length space. And that's also Gilles explained this morning, exactly when D bar equal to D. Or in other words, exactly when the distance between 2 points is the infimum of the length of all curves joining this point, which implies, if we consider a distance which is reasonable, that is most of the time finite, which implies that there are rectifiable curves. Right? So we are working on space with rectifiable curves. There are spaces without rectifiable curves, and they are interesting, but it's not the purpose of this lecture. So Philippe Cassion told me during this course, we'll always consider length spaces. Starting now, XB will always be a length space. And even more, but we'll come to that very soon. Okay, so far there is no difficulty. Well, there is an interesting, so let me put it as an exercise. There is an interesting characterization of a length metric, which is the following. I'm sorry, I have to read my notes, and I don't like that, but right. So XD is length. Well, forget about what is written above. If and only if there exists approximate midpoint, which I will define in a minute. So an approximate midpoint is a point z such that for all x, y, and x, and epsilon positive, there exists z in x, so z dependent x, y, and epsilon, of course, such that the following inequality is cool. Dxz, sorry, max dfz dyz is less than dxy over 2 plus epsilon. So a midpoint, you know what a midpoint is on a curve. So the point z would be at equal distance from x and y. And both of these distances will be alpha, full distance between x and y. We're asking to be close to that situation, but we don't need to be in this situation and this epsilon measure. And you want us to have this for every epsilon. Okay. And in fact, in the first reference here, the definition of a length metric is this, a metric which satisfies this property. And then you can prove the other property which I've used here. So that, these are equivalent definitions, but it's good to know about these midpoints, right? Okay, good. So let's have a look. I will go a little bit further. Of course, we want to talk about, so the purpose of this lecture is to talk about triangles. And what is a triangle? Well, three points, three geodesics. So points you know about, but geodesic I have to define. So let's talk about geodesic spaces. Il y a un problème, Francis? Ah non, c'est pas toi qui parlais. Bah, c'est ou toi ou Constantin. Hein. Okay, so what is a geodesic? It's quite obvious. It's a curve which somehow achieves the infinium here. I didn't say anything about the infinium, right? So it's a continuous curve from some interval. See, L is like length into x, so that for all t prime in 0 L, the distance between ct and ct prime is exactly equal to the difference between the two parameters, which is a classical definition. Well, classical definition of a geodesic in a metric space. So again, it's a bit misleading. If you have been trained to be a Riemannian geometer or a Lorentzian geometer, but not a metric spacer. I don't know if you can say so. A geodesic in Riemannian geometry is given by an ordinary differential equation, which is nonlinear of degree 2. And you can show that locally, it satisfies this property. And then globally is another story. So here we are asking, when I say a geodesic, it's in the language of Riemannian geometry, it is a minimizing geodesic, even if it's very low. Okay, but. So this parametrization will say that it is by arc length. Sometimes we could have a parametrization proportional to arc length, which means that instead of equality here, we have equality with a multiple.
This is a geodesic segment.
Yeah, well, this is the next step. Yeah. He was my student, so he has learned something.
Okay.
So indeed, this is called sometimes parameterization proportional to arc length is given like this, if it's twice the parameter, for example. So this is called a geodesic segment. We have also geodesic rays and geodesic lines. So rays are when the parameter, the set of parameters is from zero to infinity, and lines is when the set of parameters is in R. All right. Okay, so now I can give another definition, or maybe I put it here. So XD is a geodesic space. And so the condition for being a geodesic space, so the definition that we say that XD is a geodesic space, if between any two point in X, there exists a geodesic joining them. So I insist, well, let me finish my sentence. This geodesic segment from X to Y. And I insist on this, well, I check on looking at the video this morning that we don't see very well the colors, but still, I want to use some colors. And this will be an issue that there might be, in some instances, several geodesic going between two given points. So you know examples of this on the sphere, for example. The two antipodal points, they have infinitely many geodesic joining them. But in a Riemannian manifold, the points which have this bad property have measured at zero. So there are very few, well, not very few, infinitely many, but there's a small measure. And metric spaces, the situation is not the same. But we'll see that later. And yeah, so the final definition that I want to make for this very first part is convexity, because convexity will play an important role in the whole story. So a subset, let me write a definition. C, a subset of X, said to be convex if for every couple of points in C, no, point in X which are in C. So what should we say? The geodesy between them is inside, but there might be several. Do we take all of them or only one? So in this setup, we'll take all of the geodesy between X and Y. So curves whose length is exactly equal to the distance between X and Y are in C. Right, and you can do the exercise, very simple exercise on S2 with the standard metric, whichever you want, Riemannian metric or distance function, natural distance function, not the one used by R3, but the one intrinsic distance function. Then so let me take give a name. This is a sphere, this is a south pole. Then what is the ball? So when I write balls, these are open balls. The hemisphere balls around S radius pi over 2. I'll come back to the distance on the sphere later. It's convex, but not the closed ball. Right. Okay. So it happens. It often happens that when you talk about convexity, we consider closed set. But at this stage, C is any set. Right. And another remark. Another remark. If we take two points in X. X and Y, and if there is a geodesic between them, if this geodesic is unique, then this set is convex. If it's not unique, the set is not convex, and the convex hull might be very big, because you have to take all geodesics and then all geodesics between them here, and then and so on and so forth. Right? Might be a set of a full measure. So you have to keep this in mind also. Okay, very good. This is, well, very good. It's easy. Okay. So there is an example which is interesting. which are metric graphs.
Okay, so there is a very formal definition of metric graph. I will give only half of this formal definition, and then we'll stick to intuition. But still, sometimes it's good to have a very strict, strictly formal definition. So the one which is given in the book by Weitzman and Effliger is the one that I'm using. And there is another formal definition which was given a long time ago by Jean-Pierre Serre in his book, Trees. Our amalgam SL2 in French. Right. So a graph is two set vertices and edges, and a map, two maps from the edges, the space of edges to the space of sets. And as you know, D0 of E and D1 of E for E and edge are the endpoints. So you define abstractly the edges and abstractly knowing that the endpoints are among the vertices. At this stage, I didn't say anything about finiteness and anything like this, right? Okay, I cannot resist to the pleasure because it bothered me yesterday, so I don't know why it should not bother you today, to give you the very fancy definition of the metric space, the space which is the graph indeed. So it's a set of edges multiplied by some interval, say 0, 1, and where you mod out by some equivalence relation. So between edge cross the point inside the interval, and the equivalence relation is that an edge cross epsilon, and epsilon here will be equal to 0 or 1, is equivalent to another edge cross another epsilon, if and only if the endpoints. What did I write? Yeah. The endpoints are the same. Every time I write this definition, I said it's stupid. I'm sorry. This should be epsilon prime. But anyway, and they are both epsilon. So I was just saying that the edges are connected. So far for fancy definition, the graph is just a set of points and with edges between them. So edges are topologically intervals, right? Close interval if you include the vertices. Okay. Now a metric graph, you have to say how you measure the length, and it's a one, be careful, it's a one-dimensional object. So how do we measure the length? So we just assign length to each interval. So for example, this edge is here as a length, which is lambda e, right? So here the distance is just the distance between the parameters. If you identify the interval to 0, 1, which you multiply by this number lambda. Okay, and you can, and now it's easy to define the distance. So I leave it to you to define the distance. Distance between two points, just the infimum of the length of curves, which goes to continuous curves going from the one point to the other. You can really define everything in terms of this framework, but it was just for fun. Now we keep the intuitive version. So this is a very simple graph, because you could, in the definition, nothing forbids that between two points there are infinitely many edges, and nothing forbids that the distance between two points could be zero if the length of each edge is a length which is assigned to each edge goes to zero, being positive but going to zero if you are infinitely many of them, right? This kind of graph may make sense in infinite dimension. Of course, we'll be dealing with a easier, much easier family of objects, and we'll assume later that starting from one point, there are infinitely many edges. And so the distance between two points is not zero, it's never zero. So it's really a distance. It's not a pseudo distance. You can build pseudo distance like this, but here we'll consider distances. And there is another issue that we'll discuss later, which is completeness of this distance, that infinite path of infinite length. So why did I want to talk about metric graph? Well, to help Jill in his next lectures, because the most important object that he will have to deal with, except among the most important objects, are the Kele graph. Kele graphs are interesting. This is where algebra meets geometry. It's a geometric representation of a group. So it starts by taking a group which is finitely generated. Right? And finitely generated means that there exists finite sets which generate the whole group, but there are plenty of them. So you have to choose one finite set. So let's call it sigma, finite set of generators. And we most of the time make the assumption that this set is symmetric. This, if an element is in sigma, then the inverse is in sigma for particular reason. And then we can build a graph. So let me do it in a sloppy way. Start by, so the vertices are the element of gamma. And there is an edge between two elements. If you can pass from one to the other by multiplying on the right or on the left, you make your choice by an element of the generating set. So if I call sigma the element of the generating set and gamma the element of gamma, which is kind of logic, then here we have sigma one, sigma two, and then you multiply. So on the left, for example, sigma two, sigma one, the other one here, sigma one, sigma two, and so on and so forth. It's very easy to construct, and the geometry of this graph reflects partly the algebraic properties of the group. And for example, I ask this question that Jill will answer. When is this graph delta hyperbolic for some delta? Okay. So these are very interesting objects. And so in the course by Philippe Cassillon on cat spaces, they will appear, but not that much, but in the course by Jill, this will be very important. Am I right? Yes.
Yes.
Good. Let's go a bit further. So, the cat condition is a comparison theorem. It's a comparison to a model space. So first, I have to review properties of the model space. Make sure that we're using the same language. So model spaces. So there are three model spaces. I start with the, well, there are infinitely many, but there are three of them. I start by the very basic one, R2, S2, and the hyperbolic space, which was mentioned this morning also. Okay. And what we have to understand on these model spaces is the geometry of triangles, right? So for the Euclidean case, it's really easy. But let me recall one property. So let's start with R2. Well, normally I should call it E2, E for Euclidean. And I draw a triangle. So most of the time, if you draw a triangle by hand, you see that the triangle is either isosceles or the right angle. So drawing a random triangle is very difficult. But this one is random. I trained yesterday. A, C, B are the point, and the length are C, A, B. And here the angle is gamma. And we have this thing which is called law of cosine. It's a fancy name for very elementary things. C square equal A square plus B square minus 2AB cosine of gamma. It's the proof is just that the use of vectors, the square norm of AB is A C plus CB norm square, and then you just expand this. So the vector calculus on R2 is very useful to prove the cosine norm. And the cosine norm is a very big property. So for R2, for E2, it's more than sufficient. Let's go to S2, to the two sphere. So S2 is this. So the two sphere has a subset in E3. Will not be able to remember this. In a subset of the Euclidean space, a unit two sphere here. Then what should I say? Right. So points. Maybe blue is better. So points in the two sphere are unit vectors, and by definition, the distance between two points satisfies that the cosine of this distance is the scalar product between A and B as vectors. So in fact, the distance is this angle here, right? Everybody knows that. Do you know how to prove that it is satisfied triangle inequality? I hope so. So let me explain a few things. Well, we'll have to consider triangles. So maybe I should change the picture here. We have to consider triangles. So first of all, we'll have to consider so what is a geodesic on the two sphere? This is a well-known fact that the geodesics are the obtained as the intersection of the sphere by plane passing through the origin. So they are what are called grid circles, right? Okay. So these geodesics are curves which are easy to draw, and they have a unit tangent vector. Say this one is U and this one is V. And so this point is A. So the U and V are unit vectors in the tangent space to S2 at A. So as a two-dimensional subspace of R3, it is a Euclidean space with the induced metric. And so we can define the scalar product between U and V. Maybe I put arrows on U and V. And then we can define the angle between U and V, which by definition will be the angle between the two geodesics called gamma, and satisfy this equation. I'm giving a little bit too many details, because the next step will be an exercise.
not here, but
well, it's not difficult that we can parameterize this geodesic, or I can draw the grid circle here, in, which is in blue here, and put A here and U here. U is tangent here, but I can put it here, right? And so the grid circle is parametrized by a parameter T, which is the angle here, T, as cosine T A plus sine T U. And so it's parametrized by the distance indeed, because T is the cosine of the scalar, is cosine of this angle. Now T is this angle, so it is the distance between these two points. And of course, we can do this for any of these grid circle starting from a point with a unit tangent vector, right? And so now I can write down the law of cosine. S2. And the law of cosine is the following. If we take a triangle, so here there is a subtlety. I'll consider only to avoid the difficulties with the fact that sometimes the points on the sphere have lots of geodesic joining them. I will assume that the perimeter of this triangle is less than 2 pi. And that would be sufficient to ensure that everything is fine. But let's forget this for a while. So here's a triangle. My notation are maybe not very so, and I'm sorry, the angle. So the angle gamma, I will put it here. Right? And this is a length small c. This is a length small b, and this is a length small a. And the cosine law is, I have to do it to make sure that I'm not writing something stupid. Cosine of c equal cosine a, cosine b, plus sine a, sine b, and cosine gamma. Right. So this is the basis of really the core of the spherical trigonometry. And you have to know this law. Well, the more that the proof is really straightforward. So how do you prove this? Yeah. Well, cosine of C is the scalar product of A with B, considered as vectors. C is the distance between these covectors, these two vectors, and the cosine is the scalar product. And then you just expand, right, using this property. So this is cosine B times C plus sine B times U, scalar product with cosine A. I'm sorry, so this is B, well, times cosine A times C, plus sine A times B. Well, maybe A, B, B, C, mess around everything. And then you just develop this. C is a norm vector, C, C is 1. V is orthogonal to C, so C, V is 0. U, C is 0, and what's left is U, scalar product of U and V, which is cosine gamma. Okay. So it's a proof of this cosine law, and the consequence, and the corollary of this cosine law is that the distance on S2 it's really a distance, satisfy the triangle inequality. Right, so what do I mean by this? Let me give the proof of this. Simple things. Triangle inequality means that D of A, B is less than, well, I want to do it this, the way I've written, D of A, C plus D of C, B. And equality, if and only if the three points are the same on the same grid, so, right? And how did you deduce this from cosine law? Well, the proof is quite simple. We consider the function, we fix A and B, and we consider the function which to gamma associate, well, this formula, cosine A, cosine B, plus sine A, sine B, cosine gamma. And this, as a function of gamma, is decreasing, right? From the value of gamma, which makes one, this one equal to one, to the value of gamma, which make this one equal to minus one. And so this decreases from cosine of B minus A to cosine of B plus A. Right. And by the cosine law, there is a value of gamma for which this is equal to cosine of C, and cosine of C is between these two numbers. And so this is the smallest one. So cosine is not increasing, so C is less than B plus A. Okay. You don't need to do that to prove that the distance is a distance, but it's interesting to see that the most important formula in these model spaces is not the distance, but this law of cosine generates a lot of trigonometry. And in fact, this law of cosine is more important than you may expect, because it's related to something which is called the Jacobi equation. Well, so now you have the scheme, and I leave to you to do the hyperbolic case, right? Let me recall just a few things about the hyperbolic case. So the hyperbolic case is often described by a Poincaré disk, but I like the hyperboloid. So the upper sheet of the hyperboloid. So this is the real hyperbolic space. So it's included in R3, but it's not Euclidean R3. It's what we usually call E2-1. So it's the space. As a space, it is R3. With the following, so x, y, z, I have to put them in a correct order, and with a quadratic, a bilinear form, which is let's be for two vectors, u equal u1, u2, u3, and v equal v1, v2, v3, the bilinear form, I should not write it like a scalar product, it's not positive definite, is minus u3 v3 plus u2 v2 plus u1 v1. Right? That's correct. Lorentz symmetric, you should ask Andrea if you have questions. And well, and the definition of H2 is exactly the set of vectors u, so that for this, for the, well, minus u3 squared plus u2 squared plus u1 squared is equal to minus one. Am I correct? Seems to be, right? And there are two choices, the upper sheet or the lower sheet, and we have to add that we choose the upper one, u3 positive. Right. Okay, so that makes sense. So well, the point I want to make is it is a sphere, but not for a positive definite form, right? And sometimes in the books, in the old books, it's called a pseudosphere, right? And the geodesic, what are the geodesics for this space? They are exactly the intersection of the hyperboloid by plane passing through the origin. So we get a picture of the geodesic. You can do exactly the same thing that I've done here, parameterize them, and write cosine law, law of cosines. Let me write it for you without proof. And if you really want to understand this, you have to do it by yourself. So the law of cosine is, of course, cosh C, cosh A, cosh B, plus sinh A, sinh B, times cosine of gamma. And as before, from this, you deduce the fact that the distance that you get, so the distance between two points A and B on the hyperboloid is the product with this bilinear form of the two points, viewed as vectors. And this distance satisfies triangular inequality because of this law. Right? So please do these computations, and then you will understand triangles in these cases. Right? Okay, very good. By the way, these formula are all the same. So if you assume that C, A, and B are very small and you do an extension here, you'll get the Euclidean one. And the same for the sphere. So there is some kind of analytic continuation somehow. I don't know if it's possible to write them in such a way, but this is interesting. So I insist on these laws. They are more important than the distance. It's algebraic. So what are the model space? We want to define. So for those who are familiar with Riemannian geometry, Euclidean space has curvature zero, the sphere, this one has curvature one, and the hyperboloid has curvature minus one. But I want to have models for any value of the curvature. Just as to have to be constant. So here are the model space. It's very easy to extend these examples to generic model spaces. Maybe I don't need the sphere anymore. So the model spaces, which I will call M2 kappa, or we can use also MN kappa. We can do these things in dimension n, where kappa is a real number, which will be the value of the curvature. And so, well, if kappa, so here are three instances. If kappa is equal to zero, well, we have R3, R2. If kappa is positive, then, well, let me do the n-dimensional case. M n kappa is just the sphere rescaled. So you have a symmetric space, you can compute the metric, you can use this the formula that I've been giving. And of course, if kappa is negative, then this is one or a square root of minus kappa times Hn. You rescale by a positive number. Right. So there is a separation between sphere and the rest of the world because sphere have finite diameter. And this makes the trouble. And if a triangle is larger than an hemisphere, then it's a bit misleading. You don't know which geodesic to take. So we always consider triangle with small diameter, that is diameter less than some number, which is here d kappa, which is the diameter of this object. And by rescaling, this number will be pi over the square root of kappa. Is that correct? Yeah, it is correct. or kappa positive, of course. Right? So we'll consider triangles whose perimeter is less than this quantity, or twice this quantity, actually, more precise, twice this quantity. Okay. And please do the exercise to write explicitly the cosine law, not to prove, just write the cosine law for these spaces using the rescaling, just to make sure that you understand. Okay. And I'll finish this section on model spaces by the notion of comparison plane. So this is a lemma which is due to Alexandrov, one of the major characters in this story, A.D. Alexandrov, together with Buzman. And the lemma is as follows. Let me write it precisely. To take a metric space, a geodesic metric space, to be on the safe side. And let me forget about the distance. And you take a kappa, a number, which is in R. And 3 points, P, Q, R in X, right? Now, if kappa is positive, we furthermore assume, as I said before, that D from P to Q plus D from Q to R plus D from R to P is less than twice this number D kappa, right? Then there exists three points, well, triangle in the model space. Let's say M2 kappa. We can only consider M2 two dimensional because we are dealing with triangles, right? So that the distance dpq is equal to dp bar q bar. DQR is equal to DQ bar R bar, and DRP is equal to DR bar P bar. This way of writing is a bit, again, misleading because I'm using the same name for distances which are not distances in the same space. Ça va? That's it. So there is no other restriction than this one. So if you take 3 points in a metric space, right? Well, I like to think of this 3 point as a triangle. So I'd like to think that there are geodesics between them. Let's consider this case, right? Then you choose your preferred a model space. And you can find 3 points, P bar, Q bar, R bar, so that the triangles has the same side length. And so this is called the model triangle. So let's call it delta bar of PQR. So triangle in general is called delta of the 3 points P bar, Q bar, R bar. But in order to simplify, we'll use this notation. The bar here means that you go to the other space. Right, and this is the key object which will allow to define the cat notions. So I will prove that. Again, the proof is a consequence of the load cosine. So let me do the proof here. It's not a deep proof, right? So, but I want to, so to make it simple, I will call A D of P Q, B it's D of Q R, and if I'm not mistaken, C, no, I did a convex, P R, and C is D of Q R, right? So we can assume that they are arranged in this order, and I will do only the case kappa is equal to zero because I'm lazy. And I, well, if you do the case kappa equal to zero, you get the case where kappa is less than zero. You just have in the positive case this extra assumption to take into account. That's not very difficult. Right, so let me do the case kappa equal to zero. Then what? Well, by assumption, C is greater than B and is larger than B minus A and is less than B plus A, right? And now if you remember the law of cosine, so you start. So if we do it correctly, so you start with C here. You start at C. So here is C. You draw, what is C? I'm sorry, P, Q. Here is Q. And C should be here, QR. I'm sorry, I'm just been changing the name so many times. R, and C is the opposite side, Q to R, right? So you start with by choosing two points P, Q, and P, P, Q, and R, so that the distance from P to Q, A, is equal in R2. You start by choosing three points in R2, so that the distance from P bar to Q bar is equal to A. And the distance from P bar to R bar is equal to P R to B, right? And now we choose the angle. But because C is between B plus A and B minus A, cosine of C is between B plus A and B minus A. So what do you do? I talk about cosine of C. I'm lost. Well, the law of cosine here is in the Euclidean space. What I wanted to say is that these are the two extreme values in the law of cosine, and hence you can choose an angle gamma so that in the Euclidean space you get a triangle whose length here is C. Okay, so when you move the angle, there are two extreme positions. Is when these points are on the opposite side but aligned, and then you get the length B plus A, or when they're on the same line, on the same side of P on the line, and then you get a length which is B minus A. And between these two extreme positions, you can choose an angle so that any value between B plus A and B minus A could be achieved. Sorry, I messed up a little bit the proof, but it's a trivial consequence of the law of cosine. And as you see, there is nothing about constant curvature except this law. So you can do this for any kappa, right? So we can I think I need 5 minutes, right? Okay. Because when I start to mess a book like this, which is very easy, it means that I need a coffee. And I will go get a coffee for me. 5 minutes only, right? Okay,
I need five.
Well, anyway, we are not in a lot of time. If I don't finish, I don't finish. Philip will do the rest.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you for coming back. Okay. Okay, so I guess you have understood, despite my so now we'll develop from this. C'est Constantin, c'est comme ça. We'll develop from this comparison triangle, which is a very fancy object, an old theory, which is Alexandrov theory. So it's a starting point, this lemma by Alexandrov. Is the starting point of our whole theory. Another terminology is that if we have to do the following thing, sometimes take a point here and we'll use a so-called comparison point, which is a point here on the corresponding side, which divide the side in the same ratio than here. So if I use the term comparison point, it means this X bar is a comparison point for. Just because I'm sure that I will be using it without telling you what it is. Right. So this cosine law, they bring us to this comparison triangle lemma, and which will bring us to a definition of angles in the metric space, in the geodesic metric space. Again, X is not only a length space, but I will consider a geodesic metric space. Yes. So let's take two. So it's called X, this point, two geodesics starting from X, C and C prime. So C from 0, A, well, the A is meaningless. And C prime 0 A prime into X. And they are geodesics. And we'll consider two points on this geodesic, C of T, this point, and C prime of T prime, this point. Then we can have notice one thing, that the comparison triangle does not depend on the geodesic between the points, just depend on the distance. So I draw geodesic, but it's just for fun, but only distance is understood. So then we'll take the comparison triangle in R2. Well, I should say E2. Why R2 and pi S2 and not S2 or something else? Because we will be looking at angles, and our angles are infinitesimal objects here in X. And so they somehow are defined in the tangent space. And tangent space in Riemannian geometry is always R2, Rn in general. So that's why here we consider only E2. And so if you draw a comparison triangle, X bar, C prime of T prime bar, C of T bar, then you get an angle here. So this angle is written like this angle in the comparison triangle of X, C of T,
C prime. Right?
And right.
Of course, this notation uses the name here and the fact that you look at the comparison triangle. And then we can define an angle between the two geodesics C and C prime by taking the limbs of this. I'm sorry, it should be T prime here, when T prime goes to zero. And this is a so-called upper angle, upper Alexandrov angle. So it could be a limsup like this, or you could have a limsup when epsilon tend to zero and you ask TT prime to be less than epsilon, which is the same and positive, right? Okay, so it looks brutal to do this. Brute force is used here, take limsup on everything. And the question is, what can we do with this? Well, it turns out that it is very useful. So the preliminary remark that I want to make is it depends only on the behavior of C near X. If you have two different curves which share a small part here, then the resulting angle will be the same. So we usually say that it only depends on the germs of the two geodesics, right?
Like the other comparison space, you get the same definition.
Yes, of course, because it's infinitesimal.
Yeah.
Yes, yes, you're right. Okay. So in fact, we can write down this angle only in terms of what is going on in this space, just by using the cosine law in R2. So the cosine law is R2 tells us something which is translated in the following formula. J'ai réussi à pas tomber, c'est génial.
C'est pas fini. So if I use the law of cosine in R2, I can write down the following formula, which I like very much. The cosine of comparison triangle. So comparison triangle, how did that note C of zero X, I'm sorry, X, C prime of T prime, C of T is equal to 1 over T2 T prime times T2 plus T prime square minus distance from C of T, C prime of T prime square. So T and T prime are parameters, and the distances can be taken in either space because we use the comparison triangle. So this distance is equal to this distance here, right? And you can, with this formula, you can make computations because you have the parameters. So the main proposition is that, so later on, if I can reach the end, well, I can reach the end, but if I can do what I want before the end, we'll define the space of direction. And this angle looks like a distance on the space of direction. So remember to S2 in R3, is the space of direction of R3. And the angle between two vectors is exactly the distance on the space. And so the next proposition is, next proposition is that so in a space X, take three geodesics. Starting at X, small point. Right. Then the angle between C prime. C double prime, no C and C double prime, that's the way I've written it, is less than the angle between C and C prime, plus the angle between C prime and C double prime. So this is a triangular inequality for angles. It doesn't say that this angle is a distance, because there is another issue, is to check that angles is zero if and only if C equals C prime. And this is not true in general. Furthermore, this inequality is not true if we would replace sup by n. And I guess that Alexandrov has tried both to reach this definition. So this proof I never remembered. Is not involved. It's quite simple, but I never remember. I will try to do it again. This is a serious proof in this lecture. It's less difficult than the one that Jill had to do this one. Okay, so let me start. Maybe I write this on to keep the statement here. Now we proceed to the proof. So the thing you have to keep in mind, if we have three geodesics starting from the same point in a two-dimensional space, in model space, then showing that the sum is showing this is obvious. But now in the metric space, there might be, you see, not a line, but in a space with which we don't know the structure at all. Okay, so let me try to see if I can understand this proof. Okay, so it's a proof by contradiction. So if by contradiction, so if it is not true, there exists, well, I call it delta. It's not very smart to use delta here. I'm sorry. There exists a positive number delta, which has nothing to do with delta hyperbolic spaces, so that the inequality is violated. That is, j'ai n'importe quoi, ce truc, c'est pas possible. Let me try to prove this. CC prime and CC double prime. Okay. So that is violated. So C prime, C double prime is greater than. So for those who are not in the room, I just change in the statement the prime, the double prime, and so. So I apologize. C prime plus the angle between C and C double prime plus three delta. Okay, so now we just have to remember the definition of these objects. So these are lim sup. So this implies first that for every T, so this implies first that there exists epsilon positive. So that's why I use delta, because there is also an epsilon. There exists epsilon positive, so that for any t, t prime less than epsilon, the angle, the comparison angle p is c of zero. C of t, c prime of t prime, is less than the angle c, c prime plus delta. So this object is the lim sup of this when t and t prime go to zero, or when they are less than epsilon and epsilon goes to zero. So this statement here is just a definition of lim sup, right? We do the same for the other inequality, for all t prime less than epsilon, the comparison angle, so this time is c prime, c double prime, is less than the angle c double prime plus delta, right? And finally, c prime, right? I'm changing to me down this one.
C prime
is fine, right?
No. Just the names of the parameter t and t prime you use at the beginning. You use t and t prime.
Yeah. Sorry. It's, well, if we want to be coherent, I should put t and t prime. So it's a big mess anyway. So it was c double prime. So c, t, and t double prime. So it's t and t double prime, and everything is fine. Everything is coherent. Is that correct? Yeah, it is. I'm sorry. Thank you for your help. And the next one is just the fact that this is a limb suit, which is greater than that. So if you subtract a little bit, we get that there exists t prime less than epsilon, so that the comparison angle between c prime, t prime, c double prime, t double prime is greater than c prime, c double prime minus delta. Indeed, this is a limb suit. So if we get a little bit below, then for epsilon small enough, the sup is greater than this, which means that there exists only t prime, such things. Okay? So I'm trying to convince myself that I have understood. Right, now we look in R2. So we make use of a comparison triangle starting from zero in R2. So we choose t and t prime like this. And we'll use T and T prime everywhere, right? And so I draw this picture, X double prime, and here the length is T prime. So I'm starting to draw a comparison triangle, except that I didn't say anything, this angle, which I will choose to be a number alpha, satisfying the following inequality. So let me not make mistake. C prime T prime T double prime. My notation are not really good, but let me take what I have written here. C T prime prime. This is greater. So this is greater. So where did I put this? We are here. So this is greater than this. So we can put an alpha in between, right? Which is greater than the angle C prime, C double prime minus them, right? And by the way, I didn't say it before, but all these angles here are less than pi, less than or equal to pi. So this makes alpha strictly less than pi, which is useful. And so I'll use this alpha here, which is a little bit below the value of this comparison angle. So the idea that I have is to try to show that not satisfying the triangle inequality for angle will be in contradiction with the triangle inequality for distances. So I have to go from triangle to distance, right? Okay, and then what is next? I have written this c prime, t prime, c double prime, t double prime. I take the same for everybody. Is less than alpha implies, is greater than alpha implies that the distance between x prime and x double prime is less than distance c prime C prime, C double prime, T double prime, right? So if I, indeed, if I take a comparison triangle, well, if I take the comparison triangle, the angle here will be this sigma t. And so it is larger than alpha, but we are in R2. So if this angle is larger, then the distance from x prime to x double prime is certainly smaller than the distance from C of t prime and C. Well, this one could be taken equal to C double prime of t double prime. Okay, so this is one of the inequality that we need. And now it's very close to be finished, right? Now there is another, okay. So we have been using this inequality. Now we'll be using the second one. So the fact that alpha is greater than the angle C prime, C double prime minus delta implies that alpha is greater than C prime C plus angle C double prime C plus, well, two delta. We had three before, we subtract one, and we get two, right? So far, so good. And so we can choose between these two points here, the third point X. Again, we are in R2 with two angles, alpha prime and alpha double prime here. So that, so sorry, I forgot that I should stop before the end of the blackboard. So there exists a point X in the segment X prime, X double prime. So that alpha prime is greater than the angle C, C prime plus delta. Alpha double prime is greater than the angle C, C double prime plus delta. Of course, because alpha is greater than this sum plus two delta, you can, by continuity, start from x prime and move x up to the other side, and you reach a point where these two inequalities will be satisfied at the same time. Otherwise, that would contradict this here, right? And that, now that should be done. Okay, so we define t to be the distance from zero to x. So this distance here, and certainly t is less than the max of t prime t double prime, which is less than epsilon. Why? Because in a Euclidean triangle, this distance here is less than the max of the two distances on the side of the triangle. Right? Okay, so what do we get? Well, we get, then we get that the angle at P, the comparison angle at P between C of T and C prime of T prime is less than, well, it's the other one is less than the comparison angle at C and C prime plus delta. That's written over there. I can put T because T is less than epsilon, right? So less than alpha prime. And the same with the second one. P of C of T and T double prime, T double prime is less of than, so my signs are not very clear, C double prime plus delta, which is less than alpha double prime. And now we can conclude. So where should I conclude? Maybe here, right? Or maybe not a picture, but maybe I conclude here, right? So this first inequality implies, so this implies at D C of T C prime of T prime is less than D of X X double X prime. As before, the D's are not the same meaning. Well, because the angle we are in a Euclidean space is less than this angle. So the distance, so less than this angle, so D, which it means that the CFT, CFT prime is somewhere inside here, less than alpha. Okay. And the second one is that the distance between CFT, C double prime, T double prime is less than the distance of X, X double prime. Well, the sides are the same, and the angles are smaller. So in the Euclidean spaces mean that the distance of the point at the end of the rays of the segments are is smaller. Okay, so now we just have to write this distance of C prime, T prime, C double prime, T double prime is somewhere I wrote that it is greater than distance of X prime, X double prime. I'm sorry that I have erased this, but this inequality was written because of the angle. And here, because X is on the segment between X prime and X double prime, this is just equal to the sum. Because this point are aligned. And now if we plug this inside, we get that this is greater than D C of T, C prime of T prime, plus D C of T, C double prime of T double prime. And this is the contradiction. So here we get a contradiction with the triangle inequality. I don't know why I can never remember this proof. It looks very involved, but it's not. It's very elementary, but you have to find a way to explain it. And this is correct. So you have to play with this triangle. You need to have three. So now if you think that you are in a three-dimensional space, the angle might be not aligned, you see? And this is the reason why you get this kind of thing. Okay, so I think I stop here because we have another lecture after and because I'm tired. And I've not finished, but maybe I'll finish tomorrow and then Philippe Castillon will start to talk himself. Okay, thank you. So, do you have any questions?